afternoon, everyone, and warm welcome to all of you. Today, first of all, I would like to say thanks for such a great response. And from last few weeks, I am getting a lot of mails inquiring about diagnostic techniques. And the great thing is that you all are started doing diagnostic techniques in your clinical setting. And I am receiving beautiful picture of Demodex, Sarcoptes, Otodectus, Notoidris, and some cytological slides. And some of the vets have requested for hands-on training program, but unfortunately, it's not possible this year. But whenever we will have a favorable time, we will definitely do it. And I am really happy that you all are started doing cytology. So this lecture would be incomplete without doing diagnostic approach, because today's topic is pododermatitis in dog and cats, differential diagnosis and management. So as we all know, pododermatitis is the inflammation of the feet. It is the most frustrating, complicating, and the difficult part of the dermatological cases, because usually we face a lot of difficulties in treating pododermatitis, as our diagnosis is mostly dependent on the visual perception. We emphasize more on treatment part rather than finding out the etiologies. So just by listening to the webinar and picture correlation, we cannot crack any case. We need to dedicate at least 20 to 30 minutes time for every dermatological case so that we can find out the etiologies. But there are certain barriers, there are certain difficulties which demotivate us and we fail to treat a case. So these difficulties or these barriers are need to be reassessed every time whenever we treat a case. For example, number one, if any case come to us, we must check whether we have diagnosed it by using appropriate diagnostic technique or it is underdiagnosed or undiagnosed. The second thing, the case presentation is due to the breed predisposition. For example, Labrador is a breed which is prone to obesity, and Saint Bernard, which is quite massive. And the third thing is surrounding environment where the dog is kept. Is it a place with massive or water lodging, or there is a moist area? And is there any presence of some inciting factors like mud, pebbles, thorn, etc.? There are some diseases or pododermatitis cases which are refractory to the medical treatment, which may require surgical intervention. So due to the post-operative pain, wound dehiscence, and infections, they always remain questionable. And if the pododermatitis is due to the parasitic origin, for example, Demodex, and the drugs like, without doing any diagnostic, drugs like glucocorticoids are given, it predisposes the animal to the state of compromise. Similarly, there are some drugs which need to be given for 6 to 8 weeks. They are just given for few days. It leads to the similar kind of problem. And the most complicated part is when the pet is aggressive and heavy built and owner is not able to give the oral medicine, as well as he is not able to apply local application. So the things become difficult. So all these barriers, all these difficulties makes the pododermatitis still the most complicated subject. So to differentiate different presentation in pododermatitis, anatomy is of utmost importance. In order to diagnose the things, in order to make a treatment plan, we need to understand which part of the feet is affected. Here you can see the canine paw, which consists of, you can see here, this is the upper portion, which is called the carpal pad, and the lower one, this is heart-shaped, which is known as metacarpal pad, and these are digital pads. So there are some diseases which affects the pad only, and there are few diseases which affects the interdigital skin only, and there are few diseases which affects the claws only. Okay. So we need to understand all about the anatomy. Here you can see this structure is known as Duke law. Below the Duke law, number 2 digits followed by number 3, 4 and 5. Why I am focusing on these digits? Because there are variety of reasons which affects the particular digital path. For example, some obese dogs affect only the 5th path, and sometimes interdigital follicular cyst affects the 3rd, between the 3rd and 4th digits. So we should know about all these things, all the anatomy about the canine paw. So I have already discussed the affection of the feet, which involve interdigital skin only, interdigital skin plus pad, sometimes pad only. Sometimes there is the involvement of the claw. So here I have made a table which makes the things very easy to understand what are the diseases which affects only the interdigital part, which affects both interdigital skin plus pad and pad only, so that we can easily make a sensible list of differential when any case presented to us. If any case presented with only pad part is affected, for example, plasma cell pododermatitis, which is specific in case of the cat, which affects the pad part only. It will not affect the interdigital skin. Okay, so now comes the classification of pododermatitis. Classification of pododermatitis done on the basis of diseases which is common and the diseases which are uncommon, and there are some puzzling factors or perplexing factors which are mystery to solve. Now comes, and again another classification is done on the basis of PSPP system, which I have already discussed in my previous webinar on chronic otitis, where P stands for primary, S for secondary, again P is perpetuating and predisposing factor. But in my today's webinar, we will discuss classification on the basis of common and uncommon. So common causes of pododermatitis means which we see frequently or daily in our clinical practice. For example, here you can see in this table, there are 4 important causes which are commonly we see in our clinical practice. First one, parasitic, infectious, allergic, and acquired. While in case of uncommon causes of pododermatitis, which we see very rarely in our clinical practice, here you can see autoimmune, immune-mediated, psychogenic, metabolic, genetic, and neoplastic. When we talk about common, like here you can see there are diseases which are uncommon in India. For example, leishmania, which we find very rare or uncommon finding in India. But vets who are listening from other part of world, from other countries, they may come across with this problem very frequently. So the problem is common in other part of the world, in endemic areas. Similarly, when we talk about the neotrombicula, it is also very rare finding in India, but other part of the world, it is a very frequent finding. Okay, so in uncommon finding, like for example, acrylic granuloma, we see very frequently in India. And maybe some vets who are listening from other part of the world, they are also having the same kind of problems or pododermatitic cases due to the acrylic granuloma. So we will talk about this later. And here, puzzling factor, they are mystery to solve. They are very, very difficult to solve this problem. For example, here breed predilection, conformation, obesity, hip elbow dysplasia, and other related ortho ailments, and osteoarthritis. And now comes the causes of pododermatitis in case of cats. Causes of pododermatitis in case of cats almost uncommon, but there are some presentation in the clinic with the foot chewing, lameness, and bacterial infection, and sometimes they have a foot pad ulceration. So this is the diseases which we sometimes see in case of the cat, like bacterial, malassezia, pemphigus, systemic lupus erythematosus, plasma cell photodermatitis, which is very specific finding in case of the cat. Dermatophytosis, neotrombicula, pemphigus, NME, neoplasia, and trauma. So, I have already discussed that these are the findings which we commonly see in case of the cat, like if the cat is having crusted foot pad or nail beds, there might be, there is a dermatophytosis, pemphigus foliaceus, and nodules. But we need to rule it out by doing some work like microscopic examination or cytology, and hair loss and erythema, foot chewing, nail biting, because there's sometimes some diseases which are very pruritic. So these signs we are able to see in case of the cat also. And puffy foot pad also, discolored foot pad. We see in three diseases like eosinophilic granuloma, neoplasia, and plasma cell photodermatitis. So we need to rule out all these three to differentiate from one another. Now first come common causes of photodermatitis, which I have already discussed: parasitic, infectious, allergic, acquired. So first we talk about the parasitic. Under parasitic, demodicosis, neotrombicula, hookworm dermatitis, and pilodra. Among four, demodicosis is one of the major cause of photodermatitis. And we need to rule out demodex in every presentation of photodermatitis. Why? Because there are some drugs like glucocorticoids is the drug which is contraindicated in this situation or in demodicosis. So if without diagnostic, without ruling out demodicosis, and we just assuming that this might be allergy and we have given glucocorticoids, what happened? It may result in the, you know, more complicated case it becomes. And there's the proliferation of the mite, it further causes folliculitis, secondary infections, and the thing become more difficult. So we must rule out demodicosis. So always use tape strip, whether it's skin scraping or hair plug. It is very, very easy method, which I have already discussed in my previous webinar. So we can do that in every presentation of photodermatitis. Okay. So what happened in demodicosis, we all know. Like the initial sign is scaling and erythema. Later, it becomes hyperpigmented, which is very peculiar, like gray or blue-gray color hyperpigmentation. It is a diagnostic value. And sometimes there is a secondary bacterial infection, which may be due to staphylococcus pseudointermedius. It is the most frequent pathogen in case of the demodicosis. And I have seen those cases also where antibiotics like Convenia are used, but the condition never goes off. Why? Because underlying cause is not ruled out. So always focus to rule out the diseases, what's going on, okay. In demodicosis, I have already discussed that proliferation of the mite, which results in secondary folliculitis, furunculosis, bacterial infection, self-trauma, lead to the inflammation of the dorsal, ventral, and interdigital areas. And the condition can be misdiagnosed as atopic dermatitis due to the presence of pedal pruritus. So clinical sign, you can see single foot, sometimes multiple feet is involved, sometimes only feet affected, and sometimes part of more generalized diseases, all the parts get affected. It's a very painful condition when there is a concurrent bacterial infection or malassezia infection. Lymph node enlargement, pruritus variable, it depends. Sometimes it is pruritic because of the secondary infection, sometimes it is non-pruritic. And hyperpigmentation, comedon, nodule, fistula, furuncle, hemorrhagic draining lesions, and it is always associated with the immunosuppression in older dogs. So here you can see on the left-hand side that there is an acute presentation of demodicosis, where bleeding occur. On the right-hand side, you can see there's a hyperpigmentation, and it's a chronic form of photodermatitis. Again here, on the left-hand side, you can see the hyperpigmentation, just gray and bluish color hyperpigmentation. This dog was suffering from demodicosis. And here again, on the right side, you can see the hemorrhagic bullae. Here again, it is the case suffering from demodicosis. And this is again the case of husky which is having a scaling and erythematous lesions. And when we do simply the hair pluck and found a lot of demodex. Okay, so this looks like an allergy case, but don't misconfuse with that. Always do hair pluck or tape strip or scraping. You will find lot of demodex. Okay. So sometimes presentation of demodicosis is in two form, localized and generalized. Localized form, mainly 90% juvenile we'll see, and 10% adult onset. While in case of the generalized form, we see 10% juvenile and 90% adult onset because of the immunosuppression. But pedal form or pododemodicosis, we see more than a 90% adult onset.
Hatvet Pharma introduces Rajfan 50 Serum. Fenbendazole 50 mg per ml, the perfect dewormer for your pet. Fenbendazole oral suspension 50 mg per ml, Rajfan 50 syrup, antiparasitic systemic drug. Indications: anti-elementic for susceptible roundworms, hookworms and tapeworms. Dose: for dogs and cats, 50 mg per kg for 3 consecutive days. Route: oral. Presentation: 60 ml. You can book your order online at www.hatvet.com. Looking forward to a long-lasting business association. Thank you.
Now, as every, you know, patient cannot be same, similarly, our client may also not be same. Why? Because presentation of the case always depends upon the client financial basis. Because there is a single tablet like Bravecto, which is quite effective against generalized demodicosis. But this tablet is not client friendly. Okay, so sometimes we need to do the empirical therapy of demodicosis by giving ivermectin tablet at the dose rate of 400 to 600 microgram per kg. But this Bravecto do wonders. And now in Indian market, Nexgard Efoxyl NR is also available by Mariel company. It's also very good one. So now the things become very easy to treat demodicosis. Okay, worst cases we can treat it. Okay, but we need to diagnose what's going on in the skin of a dog. Okay, treat the entire dog, not just the paws. Remember. Now comes the Neotrombicula. It is also known as the harvest mite. And it is just visible to the naked eye. It is orange parasite. Sometimes it pounds alone or in clumps. And mainly it is present in the interdigital part or Henry's pocket of the ear in case of the cats. And treatment part is very easy. Just you can use the fipronil spray and short-term glucocorticoids. So this is the parasite. You can see orange color parasite between the interdigital cysts. So now comes the hookworm dermatitis. Hookworm dermatitis is also very common finding where the highly contaminated environment, poorly kept canals, because this larva present in the soil or mud. It is caused by Ankylostoma canina. What happened? This larva penetrate the skin and burrow into the hair follicle of thin skinned areas. It causes commonly on the pad, there is a papule, crust, excoriation, edema, thickening, and ulceration. In chronic cases, we see paronychia and deformed nail. Paronychia means there is a swelling around the nail. And sometimes we see systemic signs like diarrhea, anemia, weight loss. Okay. It is commonly found in the greyhound, and Ankylostoma caninum is the causative agent. But in temperate area, unseen area, more common. It is very pruritic lesion. And there is an erythema, swelling, erosion, fissures. And sometimes we see the lameness. So this is the appearance of the foot pad. And on the lower side, you can see the hookworm egg, which we see by doing the fecal flotation technique. So, but we need to rule out other differentials like bacteria, demodicosis, allergy, and dermatophytosis. And the finding is very easy. By doing just a fecal examination, we find lot of hookworm eggs. And sometimes when we need to do the histopathology, sometimes we see the larva surrounded by the neutrophils or eosinophil, or we call it eosinophilic perivascular dermatitis. Okay, so therapy is very simple. Just give the deworming tablet containing parenteral formate, 5 mg/kg, and cleaning the premises and frequent removal of the feces. Now comes the pilodra. It is very uncommon finding, although it is caused by the non-parasitic nematodes. It also feed on the deep decaying vegetations. It causes erythematous pododermatitis, and diagnosis is easy by doing just skin scraping, and you'll see the motile larva. Therapy consists of destroying bedding, spraying the environment with the insecticide, treating the patient with the scabicidal drip at least twice on a weekly basis. So this is the, you know, larva you can see easily with the skin scraping. Now comes the infectious causes of pododermatitis. So it is also one of the common finding in pododermatitis, malassezia. Okay, so when we talk about the malassezia, it's very, very common, and malassezia usually arises secondary to an underlying condition. And particularly, typically we see with the atopic dermatitis, malassezia infection, and it causes pruritus, erythema, greasy exudation, and scaling and alopecia over the dorsal interdigital web, between the foot pads sometimes, along with the brown staining over the proximal knee. Okay, so this is the typical sign of malassezia. Sometimes lichenifications and hyperpigmentation, there's a typical smell, fall odor is there because of the malassezia presence. Now you can see here, this is the case of Labrador. And this case was just, I have done the tape stripping and toothpick examination, and I found a lot of yeast or malassezia. But this case is not only suffering from malassezia. We need to rule out other underlying causes. So finally, we came to know about this case, that this case was suffering from atopic dermatitis. That's why the lesions reoccurring again and again, because we are not ruling out underlying causes. So we need to rule out malassezia, underlying causes, by doing further diagnostic technique. So that's why diagnostic technique is very important in pododermatitis case, because all look similar. All the cases look similar in pododermatitis presentation. Okay, here is the another case. Here you can see interdigital, it looks like an interdigital pyoderma. Okay, and without doing diagnostic, if you start antibiotic, what happened? It will not work. So when I have done the tape stripping, I just found a lot of malassezia, peanut-shaped yeast. And the line of treatment is completely different now. We need to give antifungal wash. We need to give antifungal spray, or sometimes need systemic antifungal. Okay, so rolling out various differential is very important by doing diagnostic technique. I am focusing on diagnostic technique because most of us still, we are not doing diagnostics. So always do the diagnostic, especially in case of the pododermatitis cases. Otherwise, the things become completely complicated. So diagnosis is very easy for malassezia by doing just tape strip cytology, and treatment sometimes only topical antifungal treatment required, like shampoos, and some time more chronic cases require the systemic antifungal treatment. And in dogs, clipping the hair coat should aid in bathing of the paws in a combination with the chlorhexidine, ketoconazole, miconazole combination. And I usually recommend twice a week. Okay, and concurrent administration of ketoconazole, that is the dose rate 5 to 10 mg/kg once in a day for 21 days is recommended. Okay, if yeast overgrowth results from atopy, you can use 1% triamcinolone acetate spray, or just to manage the pruritus. Okay, so this is all the treatment. Now comes the interdigital pyoderma. Interdigital pyoderma is also very important because this looks very similar from other differentials also. And this is of two types, superficial and deep. But deep pyoderma in the paws is one of the most frustrating condition in the dogs. And dogs with this condition have nodules, fistula, reoccurring draining tract. And this is one of the most frustrating part of dermatitis. Other diseases, because other diseases looks very similar, like demodicosis and interdigital follicular cysts. interdigital follicular cyst and interdigital pyoderma is completely different. Okay, interdigital follicular cyst, I will talk about it later. And demodicosis can look exactly like the deep bacterial pododermatitis. In fact, sometimes there is a secondary pyoderma, and sometimes they both, like two, are often present together. Okay, so while in case of the follicular cyst, when we talk about the follicular cyst, on the other hand, they usually affect only the one interdigital space. While in case of the interdigital pyoderma, all the interdigital space sometime involved. Okay, so we need to focus on podo cases or canine po very, very, you know, accurately. We need to see what's going on. Interdigital pyoderma, in any dogs with deep draining lesions of the paw, should have two diagnostic tests you need to perform, like skin scraping, just to rule out demodicosis, and bacterial culture and sensitivity test. Okay, if the test for demodicosis mites are negative, then bacterial culture and antibiotic sensitivity should be done so that the correct antibiotic is used. I heard so many cases that so many antibiotics we have used, there is no recovery. I have done lot of things, all I have done, but there is no recovery. Why? Because you have not done the bacterial culture and antibiotic sensitivity test. What kind of antibiotic is effective? Maybe your case is suffering from antibiotic resistance. So always focused. If the client says that I have already done all the antibacterial course, all I have done, so you need to work out more. Okay. So always focused on the diagnostic, and then only we can crack any case. So there are some breed predisposition or breed predilection, like Great Dane, Mastiffs, Bulldogs, Pitbull Terrier, Labrador, Golden Retriever, they have a tendency of having deep interdigital pyoderma. This is the case you can see. It's a case of Labrador presented to me, and there was a recurrent pyoderma. Why it is happening again and again? The owner gave all antibiotics, everything. When I did the bacterial culture and sensitivity, this dog and this pet is resistant to all antibiotics. All antibiotics. So I have no option. What I did, I can just do the topical therapy. I have done the topical therapy, and this case also diagnosed for atopy. And I have started treating for atopy also. So just I have done topical therapy, washing, regular checkup. Now the case is doing good, but this problem not recovered. Okay, because this case already gave a lot of antibiotic. It is resistant to that. And there is so many infections, the topical therapy will not work sometime for the systemic or the deep infection areas. And this case definitely looks like a demodicosis. Okay, I think most of the time, just for by the visual perception, we can start just giving for demodicosis treatment. And what happened? The relapse occurred. So this is the situation. Why pododermatitis cases become complicated? Because we are not doing sometimes the correct techniques. So what we need to do in this case, like we need to confirm the bacterial infection by cytological evaluation of discharge or histopathology, bacterial culture and sensitivity we need to perform. Okay, and investigate for underlying diseases like demodicosis, or is there any recent glucocorticoid therapy or hyperadrenocorticism or hypothyroidism. We need to work a lot. And this is the just special consideration when treating a deep staphylococcal infection, what we need to follow, like always choose systemic antibiotic from culture and sensitivity, like this one, this case. And systemic antibiotic, you need to give for 4 to 8 weeks. Okay. Avoid the use of corticosteroid during the antibiotic therapy and manage the other complicating underlying diseases along with this. Like there are some first-year antibiotic for superficial bacterial pyoderma, clindamycin, first-generation cephalosporin, and third-generation cephalosporin like cefovecin, which is Convania from Zoetis. and cefpodoxime. This is all the first year primary choice antibiotics. And second year include doxycycline. And when we use second year, when empirical section of first year antimicrobial drugs and topical therapy are not appropriate. Okay. And when culture indicates susceptibility, then only you choose the second tier, doxycycline, fluoroquinolones, and aminoglycosides. Okay. Then last is the third tier, when first and second tier are not appropriate and culture indicates susceptibility, linzolate, teicoplanin, and vancomycin. These are the antimicrobial drug which is strongly discouraged, and they are just only used or they are just considered to reserve for the treatment of serious MRSA infections in humans. Okay, so we need to know what kind of antibiotic should be used in what kind of condition or when. Okay, like interdigital furunculosis usually requires at least 6 weeks of antibiotic, and depending upon the culture and sensitivity. Sometimes we need to do the concurrent bathing with a medicated shampoo containing benzoyl peroxide, chlorhexidine, ketoconazole, miconazole combination several times a week. And sometimes topical application of the mupirocin ointment to focal areas of abscession can be helpful. Concurrent treating may be needed for malassezia co-infection. Okay, so always cytology is very important. You need to find out whether it is a bacteria or a bacteria with malassezia or bacteria with malassezia with some other concurrent infections. So we need to rule out each and everything. Now comes the dermatophytosis. Although dermatophytosis is uncommon, pododermatitis, it affects the keratin, hair, stratum, corneum, and pads, alopecia, scaling, broken hairs, and hemorrhagic draining lesions is uncommon in dermatophytosis. Why? Because dermatophytes or fungus only affect the keratin portion or very superficial, like stratum corneum part. That's why we are not see this hemorrhagic draining lesions. It's very uncommon in dermatophytosis. And claws can be affected in dermatophytosis. And it is caused by trichophyton species and microsporum canis. But trichophyton species is a common finding in case of the dog. Like here you can see the dog is suffering from the dermatophytosis infection, and we need to do wood slamp is just for microsporum canis. We only diagnose it by wood slamp, microsporum species, and we need to do sometimes the trichogram and culture, but culture is the gold standard for the diagnosis. Okay, we need to do culture. Then only we can able to find out what is the causative agent of the dermatophytosis. There are three species like microsporum, epidermophyton, or trichophyton. So culture is the gold standard. But dermatophytosis again, clinically and histologically, it can mimic pemphigus foliaceus and autoimmune diseases that is generally treated with the immunosuppressive drug like glucocorticoids. So it's very important to rule out any possible infectious agent before commencing treatment. Therefore, scales and hairs from the affected area should be submitted for the fungal culture, because the treatment part is completely different. They look similar, like pemphigus and dermatophyte, they look similar, but their treatment plan is complete. You cannot give glucocorticoids in case of the dermatophyte. It will adversely affect.
Hadvet Pharma introduces Azithromycin Syrup. Azithromycin 250 mg per 5 ml. The cure that embraces with care. Azithromycin Oral Suspension 250 mg per 5 ml. Azithromycin Syrup. Macrolide Antibiotic Systemic Drug. Indications: broad spectrum antibiotic against gram positive, gram negative, and other organisms. Example: Mycoplasma pneumoniae, Borrelia burgdorferi. Antiprotozoal effect against Babesia species and Toxoplasma species. Dosage for dogs and cats: 5 to 10 mg per kg once daily for 3 to 7 days. Route: oral. Presentation: 30 ml. You can book your order online on www.hatwit.com. Looking forward to a long-lasting business association, Thank you.
So systemic treatment, we all know ketoconazole, itraconazole, and griseofulvin, but it is keratogenic and do not use in animals under 6 weeks. It causes the bone marrow suppression, but ketoconazole, itraconazole is quite safe. Itraconazole we use in particularly in case of the cats, and ketoconazole is also good for fungal infection in case of the dog. But we need to focus one more thing, like we have cleared fungal infection from the dog, but we have not decontaminated the infection from the environment. It's very important because all the spores of the fungal, is spread all over the surroundings. So we need to decontaminate the environment by using anilconazole environmental spray. And sometimes we need to decontaminate the carpet by vacuuming or hot water washing. Okay. So now comes the Leishmania. Leishmania is basically a protozoal infection, which is not common. It's very uncommon in India. And this is a pic of human hand where you can see there is a overgrowth of the nail and a hypertrophy as well as abnormal curvature of the nail, which is known as the onychogryphosis. And this finding is also common in case of dog. Basically, this onychogryphosis, you can see, this is the typical finding in case of the Leishmania. Along with onychogryphosis, you will find lesions on nasal plenum too and foot pads. Okay, so don't confuse it with other diseases. You need to rule out each and everything because there are some other diseases also, some claws involved, and there's a hypertrophy or elongation of the claw. So don't think that it's a Leishmania. You need to rule out, because Leishmania, although it's very uncommon, and how to diagnose Leishmania? Basically, we need to sometimes microscopically we can see on mastigote form in macrophages, and sometimes through serology and PCR, histopathology. So it's finding is very easy. So but we need to find it, or we need to diagnose it before commencing any treatment. Okay. So treatment part is always easy when we diagnose any disease. Therapy is done by parenteral antimony compounds. Now comes the squamous papilloma. So this is the squamous papilloma. It's a viral infection. Lesions, you can see the firm hyperkeratotic horn-like appearance. And the option is I prefer the surgical excision. And we can do the cryosurgery, electrosurgery, or sometimes CO2 laser ablation. And just observe without treatment. Okay. Actually, pododermatitis is very vast topic, and I will move fast a little bit because there are so many things I have to tell about the pododermatitis. Okay, it's not a small topic, it's a very big topic. So now comes the allergic. Allergic includes the atopic dermatitis, adverse food reactions, and contact. Atopic dermatitis, as we all know, it's very common in case of Chinese Shepherd, Boxer, Cocker Spaniel, Dalmatian, Labrador is very common, and in case of Golden Retriever also, Yorkshire Terrier, Lhasa Apso, and it is always related to the food and environment. It typically begins between 6 months to 3 years of age, and it affects the lesions we see on the feet, flank, groin, axilla, periorbital, and ears. And sometimes, most of the time, secondary complications include the pyoderma, malassezia, hyperpigmentation, and lichenification. So this is the presentation of atopic dermatitis case. It's a Labrador. Here you can see the erythematous lesions on the interdigital space or on the abdomen, groin area, armpit. Okay, so this is the acute flare of atopic dermatitis, atopic. So history diagnosis is done by taking history, okay, by doing physical examination, and based on just clinical sign history, we need to exclude all other pruritic skin diseases to confirm atopy. Okay, ruled out all important differential which causes pruritus, like parasites such as fleas and mites, and particularly Demodex pyoderma, dermatophytosis, and malassezia, which causes pruritus, because it's very, very pruritic disease. and also meets the favorite criteria for the diagnosis. I have already explained in my previous webinar what is favorite criteria. Okay, so you need to confirm that topic by seeing all the signs and lesions which already explained in favorite criteria. Okay, so and also intradermal skin testing or IgE serology should only be done if the owner elects to pursue immunotherapy. Otherwise, no need to go for intradermal skin testing. This is only, you only done this thing if the owner, okay, elect to pursue immunotherapy. Otherwise, there is no use. It is not a diagnosis. Now comes the management. How to manage the pruritus. Okay, so if pruritus management of underlying atopy or food allergy is inadequate, or if atopy is seasonal and the feet are a major target, we can use 1% triamcinolone acetate spray, which is quite effective. Okay. In some cases, we need to give the non-inflammatory doses of oral prednisolone, like 0.5 mg per kg orally for short period. Okay. But ocloxacitinib is a very good drug. Apoquel can be prescribed at the dose rate of 0.4 to 0.6 mg per kg orally twice daily for up to 14 days. But unfortunately, it's not available in India. But I have experience of using ocloxacitinib in my cases, and I got wonderful results. Okay. And we have cyclosporine. We can use it at the dose rate of 5 mg per kg per day orally. Okay. And fatty acids are helpful in acute flare. Now comes the food allergy. Food allergy, generalized, or it's a non-seasonal, it causes non-seasonal pruritus most of the time. And the lesions looks quite similar with the atopy. So you need to rule out, okay, whether it is a non-seasonal or seasonal, okay. And sometimes you find gastrointestinal signs, okay. Otherwise, look-wise, it completely resembles with the atopy. So you need to ask more questions with the client, like, is there any gastrointestinal sign? It is whether it is a seasonal or non-seasonal. So accordingly, you need to, like, this is the French bulldog. You can see here, this is pet is suffering from the food allergy because the corticosteroid is not effective against this. And even cyclosporine is not working, nothing. So we came to find out that this dog is suffering from food allergy, and we have started giving the hypoallergenic food, which is quite effective in this case. And what we have done, just we have given the hypoallergenic diet, which contains very minimum, ingredients. And what is hypoallergenic? It is a restricted diet, which consists of the ingredients which are not previously eaten by the animal. Okay. Basically, one protein and one star source that the animal has not been fed in the past are used. For example, lamb and rice. Okay. So the pet is kept on this diet with all other food excluded for 8 to 10 weeks. Follow this, re-challenge with the original diet, and confirmation of the AFR or adverse food reaction is made if the pruritus and otitis disappear during the dietary trial and reassume immediately following the reintroduction of the offending food. Okay, so we can able to find out the cause whether the case is suffering from food allergy or not. But this part is very difficult to convince the owner. Okay. Client compliance is so much in this. But sometime when you know the things, when you diagnose the things, you can convince your client by doing the various diagnostics. And it all depends on faith. Okay. Now comes the contact allergy. Contact allergy, how you differentiate it from atopy or food allergy. Basically, it's very, contact allergy is uncommon as a cause of pedal dermatosis. It also causes the same like erythema, papule, alopecia, and pruritus on the ventral surface of the feet. But the typical thing is that pruritic papules on the palmar plantar aspect of all 4 feet is typical clinical presentation. In case of the contact allergy, if a carpet or a grass causes a contact allergy, okay. And sometimes other contact areas that are also frequently affected are muzzle, perianal, and ventral abdomen. Okay, that's why it looks very similar with the atopy or food allergy. But you need to differentiate. The contact part become erythematous or there's a papular eruption. Because in case of the contact, all 4 feet involved, and sometimes in atopy, only the front feet involved initially, then hind limb. And in case of the flea allergy, when we talk about the flea allergy, mostly the hind feet involved. So you can differentiate according to clinical sign or history. So this is the German Shepherd having the contact allergy. This is, you can see, it's all contact allergy. And the clinical management is easy. Just you need to give glucocorticoids either orally or topically, or try to avoid the exposure. And for temporary exposure, you can give the pentoxifilin 48 hours prior to known exposure to minimize the elicitation phase. Okay, it will help. Pentoxifilin. And pentoxifilin also can be used in place of the glucocorticoids for long-term management. Now comes the acquired or traumatic. Like pododermatitis is itself is a very complex and challenging subject. But pododermatitis due to foreign body is one of the most complicated cause of pododermatitis. In the present scenario, it is one of the hot and burning topic throughout the world. Because what happened? The trauma due to foreign body, it leads to the development of interdigital follicular cyst. Okay, and what we see regularly and frequently in our clinical setting. And the challenge we face that we are not able to diagnose the cause. What is happening? Why it is reoccurring? We are not able to find out the cause. And this problem reoccur again and again. And when we talk about the treatment, there is the treatment failure. Even by using the course of antibiotic, broad spectrum use of antibiotic, no work of antibiotic, no antifungal work, nothing. So what happened? Why it is happening? So this one, I think this pododermatitis cause is one of the most challenging part of the pododermatitis, interdigital follicular cyst. So we need to understand about this, how it happens, why it happens. Okay, so here you can understand, this is the cycle I have made. Basically, David Duclos is the first person who really look at the pathology of this interdigital follicular cyst. What happens? There is the inflammation of one or more hair follicles, okay, on the ventral surface of the interdigital web. Okay, then what happened? After that inflammation, there is the rupture of hair follicle. Then hair material or hair follicle material goes into the dermis, and it acts as a foreign body there. Okay, so then it further causes the furunculosis, infection, secondary infection, erythema, and there is the development of the sinus tract. And after that, through this sinus tract, the infection goes up on the dorsal surface of the interdigital web. And what we usually see, that cyst develop on the dorsal surface of the interdigital web. But we are wrong. Basically, this cyst develop from ventral surface, then come up on the dorsal surface because of the formation of the sinus tract. Okay, so always check the paw from both the sides, palmar or plantar surface and the dorsal surface. It's very difficult to manage this condition. So think about it. So further, what happened when the formation of the interdigital cyst, when the case become chronic, there's a scarring, and sometimes because of the altered conformation, weight bearing, again due to the friction on the hair follicles, which is present on the adjacent part of the pad, which the cycle goes on. Okay, hair follicle rupture, then again infection. So again, relapse or reoccurrence of the interdigital follicular cyst. Okay, got it. Like here you can see, it's a beagle, and you can see the redness, or there's a punctured hole, ruptured skin you can see from the ventral. This is known as the palmar surface. Okay, palmar is the front leg and the plantar is the second hind leg. So there's a rupture, hair follicle goes into the dermis. It causes it. There's a development of the sinus tract, and through sinus tract, what happened? There's a formation of the interdigital cyst on the dorsal surface of the interdigital web. So we need to work out on this. So this is the you can see how it looks like. The therapy for recurrent interdigital cyst is quite exhaustive because it antibiotic will not work. Okay, for temporary relief, but not full recovery, we find. And sometimes cyclosporin or vitamin E, tetracycline, niacinamide, retinoids, pentoxifilin, mupirocin. Frankly speaking, this all will not work against this. We need to do fusion podoplasty and CO2 laser ablation of the ventral cyst. Okay, so CO2 laser ablation is a very effective treatment because it cuts and ablates and seals. It is very quick, no blood, less hemorrhage, less pain, less infection, and faster healing. And I am very lucky that I have CO2 laser surgery and doing this. Okay, but you need to be very cautious while doing laser surgery because it may penetrate the surrounding structures. Okay, so always when you are using your laser, CO2 laser, you need to focus what area you need to ablate. So just focus that area, then start ablation. Otherwise, sometimes this laser light can penetrate any surrounding structure, even your hand. Now comes the sterile pyogranuloma, and it is also very perplexing factor, or they are very mystery to solve this problem also. And but the great thing is that we can diagnose it by doing the microscopic examination. And commonly there is a nodular lesions without draining tract. It is commonly seen in bulldog, great dane, boxers, golden retriever, dachshund. And again, the same thing, same pathology, like rupture of the hair follicle, initiate foreign body response on the dorsal aspect. Erythema, ulceration, serosanguinous discharge, rupture, this type of lesions you can see also in case of the sterile pyogranuloma. So this is the microscopic examination. Basically, in pyogranuloma, you can see the foamy macrophages, a lot of foamy macrophages, neutrophils, but no bacteria. That's why the term used, the sterile pyogranuloma infection, is sterile, no bacteria. And the treatment part is what we use in tetracycline and niacinamide. Basically, under 10 kg body weight dog, you can use 250 mg. And more than 10 kg body weight dog, you can use a 500 mg every 8 hours in case of the dog. And prednisolone orally, like at the dose rate of 2.2 to 4.4 mg per kg once daily until their lesions have regressed. Prednisolone works very nicely in pyogranuloma cases. If the dogs are unresponsive to glucocorticoids, cyclosporin we can use at the dose rate of 5 mg per kg once daily alone. Azathioprine is also useful in such cases, but it is contraindicated in case of the cats. Okay, in cats, similar regimen use, except that chlorambucil is used in place of azathioprine. Now comes the uncommon causes of pododermatitis, which includes the autoimmune. First, we talk about the autoimmune, in which pemphigus complex and SLE. Pemphigus foliaceus is the most common autoimmune disorder, but although it's still rare. PF is a pustular disease leading to erosions and crusting. It affects the face also, along with podo or paw. It affects the face also as a butterfly pattern, affecting the periocular region, bridge of the nose, and nose itself. Foot pad keratosis is common in dogs, especially. Notice this thing. I am telling about the key feature of pemphigus foliaceus. You will see the hyperkeratosis, especially on the edge of the pad. Only on the edge of the pad most of the time. And paronychia in cats may be the only sign. If cat is suffering from pemphigus, you will see the paronychia around the nails.
Hatwood Pharma introduces Hatclav 375 tablets. Amoxicillin 250 mg plus potassium chlorinate 125 mg. Potentiated aminopenicillin systemic drug. Bactericidal aminopenicillin with beta-lactamase inhibitor with extended spectrum of antibacterial activity. Amoxicillin and potassium chlorinate tablets. Indications: for treatment of urinary tracts, skin, and soft tissue infections caused by susceptible organisms, particularly gram-positive bacteria and anaerobes. Indicated for canine periodontal disease due to susceptible strains of bacteria and for treatment of bacterial respiratory tract infections. Dosage for dogs 13.75 mg per kg, for cats 62.5 mg per cat every 12 hours for 5 to 7 days or 48 hours. Route oral. Presentation 1 into 10 tablets. You can book your order online at www.hatwit.com. Looking forward to a long-lasting business association. Thank you.
In case of cats, and lesion on feet alone, otherwise unusual, usually with the pinnal lesions, nasal and periorbital lesions, these lesions usually we see in case of the dog, along with the paw, all other things also we can see in case of dogs. Like here, this is the case of the pug. Here you can see the periphery of the, like periphery of the pad is involved. Okay, edge of the pad is involved. And also other crusty lesions on the ear. This is the cat. You can see the periphery of the, you know, pad is involved. And this indicates the pemphigus. If you just want to see on your visual perception, you can suspect it that it can be the case of pemphigus foliaceus. But what we need to do further work up, we need to do the cytological examination of the purulent material, which reveal larger number of neutrophil, eosinophil, and acantholytic keratinocytes. Okay, and histopathology, on histopathology, we will find the subcorneal vesicles or pustules containing acantholytic cells, neutrophil, or sometimes along with eosinophil. And acantholytic cells are the hallmark of pemphigus diseases. Key features, what are the key features of PF? They are non-pruritic. Okay, pruritus can be present, but it is not a striking feature of the disease. Papule and pustule look similar to pyoderma. Pyoderma, but what happened? Pyoderma typically does not affect the pinna, bridge of the nose, and periocular area. So you can differentiate it from pyoderma. And cytologically also you can differentiate, like pustule shows no bacteria in case of pemphigus, but in case of pyoderma, you will see sometimes a lot of bacteria. In case of the pemphigus, you will see intact neutrophils and acantholytic cells, and paw pad have a peripheral erythema. I am more focusing on peripheral erythema. You have to remember this. And hypertrophic to cracked pad sometimes. Treatment is complex in pemphigus, but not so tough. We can start up with a glucocorticoid high dose, like induction dose at the dose rate of 2.2 to 4.4 mg per kg per day. And in case of the cat, 4.4 to 6.6 mg per kg per day, induction dose. Okay, and induction dose continue until disease remission. Azathioprine also works good, like at the dose rate of 2 to 4 mg per kg orally, every 24 to 48 hours in case of the dog. And I have already discussed that in case of the cat, it is contraindicated due to the risk of severe bone marrow suppression. So in case of the cat, in place of azathioprine, we can use the chlorambucil at the dose rate of 0.1 to 0.2 mg per kg orally. And some other drugs like cyclophosphamide, tetracycline, niacinamide, you can use. Now comes the systemic lupus erythematosus. Systemic lupus erythematosus is also autoimmune condition. And how we differentiate it from pemphigus? It looks like pad and paw lesions looks very similar with the pemphigus. The only difference is that along with the pad, here you see cyclical fever, polyarthritis, kidney diseases, as well as the skin diseases. Okay, so along with the skin diseases, you will see the polyarthritis, kidney diseases, cyclical fever, which is a typical finding in case of the SLE. Okay, so ulceration and thickening of the foot pad may also occur like this. And diagnosis, how to diagnose? We need to diagnose by using anti-nuclear antibody test, biopsy for histopathology and immunopathology. And on biopsy, what we find, hydropic degeneration or intracellular edema of the basal cell in the basal layer of the epidermis, and the boundary between the dermis and epidermis become undefined. and apoptotic keratinocytes or cell death, loss of melanin from the epidermis you see. Immunosuppressive doses of prednisolone with or without azathioprine or cyclophosphamide. Like treatment is quite similar with the pemphigus. Now comes the immune mediated, which includes the vasculitis and erythema multiforme. Vasculitis, it's an immune complex deposition occur on the feet and ears as well as other part of the body. It is basically caused by the drug, vaccine reactions or some infectious causes. And typical presentation, what are the typical presentation of the feet is, okay, key feature, this is the key feature, okay, observe carefully. Presence of ulcer in the center of the foot pad. The ulcer size varying depend upon the severity and the size of the blood vessels affected. Like here you can see, there is an ulcer at the center of the foot pad. Okay, now comes the diagnosis. Histopathology is important in all autoimmune as well as immune-mediated diseases to confirm or to diagnose the particular diseases which causes pododermatitis. Okay, although many cases of vasculitis are idiopathic, sometimes we are not able to diagnose why there is a vasculitis, why there is a necrosis occur. Okay, some these causes are idiopathic. So we need to attempt all those things to identify an underlying cause. So treatment is same pentoxifilin, 25 to 30 mg orally every 8 hours, and corticosteroids, topical and systemic as per the condition. Tetracycline, niacinamide may be used for milder form. Tacrolimus spray you can use, omega-3 fatty acids, and care with subsequent vaccination and drugs. If implicated, it will respond to treatment several weeks to month. So this is the case. You can see erythema multiforme. Erythema multiforme, the lesions is very typical. It looks like a bullseye appearance. So you can easily diagnose it by just seeing the lesions. And there's a classic lesions are erythematous macule with a paler central area. It is just opposite to vasculitis. Like in vasculitis, there is a central ulcer. And here in the center, there's a paler area. And in the surrounding, erythematous macule. Okay, so important to take a thorough history of medications, vaccines, keeping in mind that drug can trigger this type of cutaneous reactions. So diagnosis is done by biopsy, okay, in which the individual apoptotic cells are evident. Immunosuppressive treatments are typically prescribed in case of erythema multiforme. So this is the, you can see, this is the lesions we commonly found in case of the erythema multiforme. Now comes the psychogenic. Under psychogenic acrylic granuloma, which is a very common finding we see particularly in case of the Labrador, GSD, Great Dane, Doberman, they are overrepresented breed. And what happened in this, the dog urged to lick from the, lick the lower portion of one of their legs. And lesions initially be red, swollen, irritated and bleeding is there. The animal incessant licking of the lesions eventually results in a thickened, firm, oval plaque, which is called granuloma. And major cause appears to be a psychological related to stress, anxiety, and boredom. One theory is that excessive licking causes endorphin release, which reduces pain and make the animal feel euphoric temporarily. That effect then causes an addiction to licking. Other triggers include itchy skin, painful condition caused by the trauma to the skin, arthritis, neuralgia, and peripheral neuropathy. A bacterial and fungal infection of the skin can also trigger itching. There are so many reasons. Okay, so we need to rule out all the lesions why animal is licking continuously of that particular area. So do not make a diagnosis of psychogenic disease until all other avenues have been explored. So this is the case. You can see it's the case of Labrador. Due to the continuous licking or chewing at the particular part of the area, it become red, thickened. Like here you can see. So they are also very miserable cases. They are very difficult to treat these cases unless or until your client is cooperative. Otherwise, this is also one of the cause of the frustrating cause of pododermatitis. So treatment of primary cause, if known, is essential. In psychogenic cases, dealing with the psychological factor is most important. Like, factor should be identified, such as being left alone all day, being confined, or changes in the household. So correction should be done. First of all, you can do increased walks, avoiding confinement and more interaction in the home. You can suggest the owner, you can do this thing. And sometimes we need to give the antidepressant drugs like amitriptyline at the dose rate of 1 to 3 mg per kg orally, and clomipramine, fluoxetine, and sertraline. And sometimes if there is any secondary bacterial infection, you can give the systemic antibiotics just to prevent the bacterial infection for long term, like for 6 weeks or longer. And my favorite is Elizabeth collar, but sometimes the client or your dog is so aggressive, he what happened, they cannot wear this Elizabeth collar because of the aggression. Okay, it will not help in the aggressive dog. But yes, if the dog is docile, you can use the Elizabeth collar during the course of therapy. And opioid antagonists such as the naltrexone, almefine, loperamide can be used to reduce the addiction to licking because it's endorphin blockers. And sometimes licking can be prevented. I have already discussed that Elizabeth collar. And topical medication, it's not my favorite because animal used to lick all the time. Yes, on those cases, you can use successfully applied the Elizabeth collar. Then you can apply the topical medications like corticosteroid and neurocream and intralesion steroid. So in this, laser therapy is quite successful, and overall lick granuloma are very difficult to treat. Okay. This is another term, acral mutilation syndrome. This is unusual sensory neuropathy. AMS is a rare autosomal recessive genetic disorder that affects sensation in the extremities of the dog. This results in progressive mutilation of their pad and paws due to the absence of pain. Animal doesn't feel any pain. Okay, single or multiple feet can be affected, though dogs can walk without pain or lameness. Otherwise, motor skills, coordination, reflexes, all appears to be normal. It is particularly reported in German short-haired and English pointer. This disease is very pathetic, and it occurs in 3 to 5 month old puppy. So what are the corrections? What we can do? Basically, here I have explained that why it happens. Okay, there is a mutation in the regulatory gene of GDNF, which reduces the level of GDNF protein, which affects the axon development in the neurons of the dog. This is what decreases pain and temperature sensation in the dog. Okay, if the disorder proves to be unmanageable, generally what we do, euthanize the dog. So parents of the affected dog should never not be bred. Okay, we need to see this point. We must check this point. Now comes the metabolic. It is very important disease, that is superficial necrolytic dermatitis. And this is also one of the most important cause of pododermatitis, and sometimes we miss it. Okay, and there is it is a very rare finding in case of a dog, but we see in our clinic, this superficial necrolytic dermatitis. It is associated with a chronic liver failure and glucagon-secreting pancreatic tumor. Skin lesions often the first sign. And the lesions is because of the keratinocyte damage due to the cellular starvation and nutritional imbalance. Although all the pododermatitis cause we can diagnose by doing the microscopic examination, cytology, and we can able to diagnose it. Most of the pododermatitis cases. But this is the cause, like superficial necrolytic dermatitis is the cause of pododermatitis, which we require the ultrasound, as well as the biochemical parameters and other workup. Okay, so like here, this there are some other terms also we use for the superficial necrolytic dermatitis, that is necrolytic migratory arrhythmia, hepatocutaneous syndrome and metabolic epidermal necrolysis, usually seen in middle-aged to older dogs. And it causes, what are the striking signs? It causes the foot pad hyperkeratosis. Okay. And metabolic, why it is called metabolic diseases? Because there is an amino acid deficiency, which causes the crusting and ulceration lesions in the groin also, perioral, as well as paw pads. And the typical sign is the crack and fissures you will see in case of the necrolytic migratory erythema. So here you can see, this is the fissure, you can see very clearly on the paw pad, and there's sometimes erythema and erythema around the mouth, eyes, occasionally pinna, genitalia, perineum. And sometimes we can see the secondary malassezia infections, and systemic signs are inappetence, possible PUPD if diabetic. Other signs you also need to see. So this is the case presented in my clinic. You can see how bad paw pad is looking. And you can see also there's the claws, almost removal of the claws itself, and very painful condition. Animal become lame. Also, animal is not able to walk properly. And so hyperkeratotic lesions is this. So we have worked up for further examination. And this animal is also in anorexic, not eating properly. So we have we just suspected that it could be. So we have diagnosed it by doing the workup that the case is suffering from NME. So diagnosis is easy, but you need to work up more. Just don't treat the paw pads. You need to treat whole dog. And some systemic involvement is there, liver or pancreas. So you need to look all those systemic organs also. Like in biopsy, we will see the parakeratosis, spongiosis, and epidermal hyperplasia of the basal cell layer. Red, white, and blue layer are considered characteristic. And when you do the ultrasound, what happened? The liver looks like a honeycomb appearance or Swiss cheese. And on serum, you will find the hypoaminoacidemia and hyperglycemia. I'll see sometime. Prognosis is poor. However, some respond to the intravenous amino acid therapy. So this is the liver on ultrasound. You will see the hyperechoic images, and hyperechoic looks like a cheese or a honeycomb appearance. Now comes the treatment. You can provide the intravenous amino acid therapy. And if there is any secondary malassezia infection, you can give the antifungal, or egg yolk is very effective in case of this infection NME. Like 1 egg yolk per 5 kg body mass is very effective, and which I have given in my case. And zinc supplement and essential fatty acids and low fiber, highly digestible diet is recommended. Treatment of the underlying liver disease would be the best option. Glucocorticoids are usually contraindicated, as many affected dogs are either diabetic or borderline diabetic. So overall, there's a poor prognosis if you are not able to diagnose this case timely. Now comes the genetic. Zinc responsive or idiopathic, zinc responsive dermatitis, as we all know, it's very common in Siberian Husky and Alaskan breeds. Syndrome 1 and syndrome 2 occurs in rapidly growing puppy that are often fed poor quality dog food or over supplementation with the calcium, which is linked to reduced zinc uptake in the gastrointestinal tract. So clinical sign, we see generalized crusting plaque with extensive crusting and fissuring of the foot pad. That's why, see, the clinical signs are almost similar from one another. So that's why the diagnostic approach is very important in porodermatitis cases. So this is the lesions you can see. And sometimes when you do the cytology, you will find the parakeratotic or retention of the nuclei in the keratinocytes cells. So diagnosis by history sign and histopathology. Histopathology, you'll see the classic hyperkeratosis that is predominantly parakeratotic, and corneocytes have a retained nucleus. Okay, this is the differential. So response with the zinc sulfate at the dose rate of 10 mg per kg or zinc methionine at the dose rate of 2 mg per kg. idiopathic pododermatitis. There are few cases where, despite thorough workup, definitive underlying cause cannot be identified. Such cases can be defined as idiopathic, and in these cases, laser surgical technique is advised. Okay, because the condition becomes so worse. Pathogenesis is unclear, but the presence of large number of lymphocytes and plasma cells is suggestive of immune reactivity or antigenic drive. Lesions develop on one foot, but then spread to mostly other feet, and combination of the erosions, ulcers, nodules, and draining tract commonly seen on the dorsal and ventral surface of the feet. So diagnosis is just based on exclusion and confirmed by the typical histopathology and response to the immunosuppression. But this case failed to respond with the antibiotics, and clinical improvement with the immunosuppressive dose of the prednisolone and cyclosporine for 2 to 8 weeks. Okay. So this is the case of idiopathic. We are not able to diagnose this case. You can see this is the case of the beagle. All four limbs or all the paws, four paws or hind paws are affected. And this case was not responded with the antibiotics, antifungal, nothing. But it is only responded with the immunosuppressive dose of the corticosteroids. So this is the cytological findings where we can see the lymphocytes and plasma cells sometimes. Now comes the neoplastic squamous cell carcinoma and epitheliotropic lymphoma, which affects the foot very commonly. We see, and usually the SCC we see in case of the dog over 7 years of old dog, and the predisposed breeds are Labrador, Poodles, Rottweiler, and Jordan Setters and Caribou Terriers. Dogs with multiple digit involvement sometimes, which is called as the metastatic carcinoma. So this is the, on radiograph, you will see there's a bone lysis on radiograph and ulcerative tissue protruding below the nail plate. Sometimes we need to do the amputation of the nail. Okay. And now comes some epitheliotropic lymphoma. It is also occur in older dogs, 8 years or older, which is also known as the mycosis fungoids in case of the human. And it causes the depigmentation of the paw pad, lips, eyelids, and nasal plenum, which is caused by the infiltration of the lymphocyte into the skin, which is a classical sign. Okay. And in this case, prognosis is poor. And what we can do, just give the prednisolone or sometimes lomestine for the treatment of epitheliotropic lymphoma. So this is the hyperkeratotic depigmentation and infiltrated foot pads. Now comes the puzzling factors or perplexing factors, which are mystery to solve. Like sometimes you see the conformational disorder, breed predisposition, obesity, hip dysplasia, osteoarthritis. Like conformational disorder is a very frustrating cause of pododermatitis. I have seen mostly in case of the beagle, or also in case of the heavy set dog with excessively split feet, which results in the weight bearing on hairy part of the feet adjacent to the foot pad. It triggers the inflammation of the hair follicle. And when there is the inflammation of the hair follicle, same that I have discussed in recurrent interdigital follicular cyst, what happened? There is a damage of hair follicles and results in the chronic inflammation within the feet. So because of the conformational disorder, there is a friction, there is a rupture of the hair follicles. Again, that follicles material goes into the dermis, acts as a foreign body, and this causes the chronic inflammation within the feet. So this feet looks like this. It's my case of beagle, and it's a very, very frustrating case because you can see here, and this beagle was heavy, obese. And because of the obesity and the paws also there is a conformational defect due to which there is the friction, and this causes this condition. So here you can see this is the pseudo pad. This is a normal pad, but here you can see this is a fusion of the pad, and there is the formation of the pseudo pad because of the weight bearing on the hairy part of the skin. Okay, so the foot look like this now. So this is also the example of, here you can see the pseudopad. Okay, this is called the pseudopad. And this is the splayed feet. It is the case of my German Shepherd having the splayed feet and having pododermatitis because of the conformation. And obesity also, you all know that obesity is one of the reason of pododermatitis because of the excess weight on the paws. It causes friction, inflammation, and chronic, And I have generally seen, I have observed most of the cases who are obese, they just, there's the involvement of this digits, 5 or 2 most of the time. But here also you can see, because of the weight bearing, this area and this area become affected. So this is the another case you can see. This is also the obese dog. And because of the obesity, there is weight bearing, and sometimes we see the hyperkeratotic foot pad. And here also you can see the hyperkeratosis of just the fifth digit. Hyperkeratosis, or what is sometimes fronds. What is fronds? Here you can see this is basically, we called it fronds. This one is the front, just a thread like material. Sometimes we see in obese dog because of the hyperkeratosis of the foot pad, and otherwise it causes no problem. But sometimes while walking, there is some lameness, it show, but very rare, very rare. Otherwise it causes no harm, but client are sometimes curious to know about it, and you can tell that it's a fronds. And sometimes what is the treatment you can do? You just trim that fronds, which are extra growth of the pad. You can trim it, or just apply the propylene glycol or some soothing cream. And there are a few diseases. I will move fast a little bit because we have very less time to cover all those things. Claw and claw fold diseases. So these are the some terminology, onychoclasis, breaking of the paw, onychocryptosis, ingrown claw. We should know about it. Onychodystrophy is abnormal claw formation. Onychogryphosis, I have already discussed in Leishmania. Onychogryphosis is very important term, where there is a hypertrophy and abnormal claw curvature, which is common finding in Leishmania. Onychomedesis, sloughing of the claw. Onychomalacia, softening of the claw. Onychorhexis is longitudinal striation associated with the brittleness and breakage of the claw. Onychocesia, splitting or lamination of the claw, usually beginning distally. Paronychia, inflammation of the nail fold. Okay, so many terms regarding abnormalities of the nail. We should know about it. So there are some lesions, but we will discuss about it. Symmetric leupoid onychodystrophy, which is very important finding in case of the young adult to middle-aged dog. And GSD, Rottweiler, and Labrador, Boxer, they are the common breed which are commonly affected. And what happens in this progressive shedding of the multiple nails on all the 4 feet over a period of weeks to months, and the nail becomes soft, sloughing, sometimes pain, so much painful condition it is. And separation of the claw from the bed and brittle. Nail become very brittle and breaking themselves. So here, this is the case of mine of Rottweiler. And it's a very young dog. He's just, I think, 11-month-old dog. And he's having such a problem. You can see here, paronychia is there. So inflammation around the nails, and nails is coming out. Very brittle nail, sloughed out. Okay, look very painful. So this is, there is the hypertrophy of the nail. Okay, looks like a Leishmania, but it's not a Leishmania. Okay. Now the treatment is easy. High dose of the essential fatty acid, sometimes it helps in these cases. Or we can use tetracycline, niacinamide, pentoxifilin, and prednisolone, along with the cyclosporine or azathioprine. And clinical improvement, usually we see within 3 to 4 months by using this medicine. Now comes the feline plasma cell podo. I will discuss only the feline plasma cell pododermatitis in case of the cat, because this is the specific finding in case of the cat. And particularly you will see the violet tint with white striation. This is the white striation. Okay, particularly in feline plasma cell pododermatitis. And this is also known as a pillow pad disease in case of the cat. Okay. But you need to rule out all other diseases which affects the foot pad of the cat, like neoplasia or eosinophilic granuloma, by doing the cytology or biopsy. We need to rule it out. But this plasma cell pododermatitis is a very typical finding. You can diagnose it by just visual examination. Pillow pad. The pad becomes, particularly the metacarpal pad becomes swelled. So this is the video I'll show you. I have a case of cat having the metacarpal pad involvement, and when we have diagnosed, it came out positive for the plasma cell pododermatitis. what we need to do for the treatment, just changing the type of the litter, and the treatment, you can use the doxycycline at the dose rate of 10 mg per kg once in a day. Or if the treatment fail, you can use the oral prednisolone 4.4 mg per kg once in a day. And cyclosporin also helps in these cases. Investigation approach, why I have made this table for you, because investigation for the differential diagnosis, investigation is the, you know, very important. Investigation approach is very important so that we can differentiate like what kind of the investigation we can do for what kind of the diseases. So these things should remain in your mind. Like if any parasitic infection is there, what we can do, dermatophytes and allergy. Sterile, for allergy, ruled out all the differential. Okay. And when the disease affects the interdigital skin plus pad. So when you study again and again, what kind of diseases affects the skin or pad. And when you experience by seeing a lot of cases in your clinics, the things become very easy. You need only this. You can understand what investigation approach I can do. Okay. So according to disease, which part of the feet is affected. Okay. Like for pad, only six differential is there. So most of the time we need to do the biopsy or cytology. We can easily find out the cause, what causes the pad part. So I will very quickly discuss the case. Like case number one, it's a Labrador, intact nail, and 2.5 year old age. But the weight you can see here, the 45 kg. The clinical sign, owner is complaining for the lameness from last few days in left hind limb. So on ortho and neuro exam, no abnormality found. On X-ray of hinds, no abnormality found. On physical examination, I have seen sore and cracked pad with fissures. You can see here. Okay, how painful it is seen. Because of this lesion, the dog was unable to walk properly on the floor. So owner was so happy after knowing this. Because after a week he came with happy face. I have just treated it with carprofen because the condition was so painful. And I have given the omega fatty acids, Cortex, my favorite. And the topical application with the 7F. And I have also set for propylene glycol just for soothing effect. So after a week, you can see the paw pad look quite normal. So case number two, it was a Labrador male, 8-year-old, and the body weight was 36 kg intact. Clinical sign was inappetence, intermittent vomitions, and hard foot pad with cracks and fissures, unable to walk. With this clinical sign, maybe you are now able to diagnose what which disease I am talking about. Hard foot pad with cracks and fissures, okay? Crusty lesions on the testicles and crust and fissures on the foot pad. I have written two times, crust and fissures on foot pad. So what it indicates? So this is the dog. You can see the scrotal become ulcerated and the dog looks so thin. And you can see here the foot pad. How bad foot pad is this? And what we have diagnosed, basically on cytology, we found only malassezia. Then we think that it may be some concurrent malassezia secondary infections. And then we have sent the sample for biopsy, and there we find the epidermal hyperplasia of the basal layer, red, white, and blue. So what it indicates? SNE, superficial necrolytic erythema. On ultrasound, honeycomb appearance of liver we have seen. And on biochemical examination, we found the excessive liver enzymes, and bilirubin, jaundice, etc. And after treatment, it takes hardly, I think, 1 month to recover, just 1 month. And dog was look like this now. So pretty. And you can see the pad become smooth and, very good in appearance. So treatment part, when we have diagnosed that the dog is suffering from NME, then we can start a treatment according to the diagnosis, like amino acid infusion. And when animal started eating, then we have prescribed for egg yolk. Okay, and S-adenosyl methionine just for liver disturbances because liver involvement was there. So we have provided the lisibine or SAMI and topical application with the antifungal because we have found Malassezia on cytology. Now case number three is it's a beagle 4 year intact and clinical sign was erythema, swelling, nodules, hemorrhagic bullae and draining tract. Started from the forelimb paws and extended to all paws. Poor response to antibiotics and antifungal. Very frustrating case. This case is still I am waiting for this case to treat. And I am planning that we will do the CO2 laser surgery. Because the problem is not resolving in this case. There is no effect with the antibiotic or antifungal or corticosteroid even because this case is, age is not, corticosteroid. We cannot give in such an age for a long time. So we need to do something, instantly. And we need to do some laser surgery to remove that cyst because owner is very much interested in this. So we are planning for that. In the next 2-3 days, we will do it. Now, case number four is the Dalmatian male, 1.5-year-old. So here you can see it's a very interesting case. And you can see all the body parts are involved. There's a bleeding, erythema, and there's a crusty lesions. Here you can see how bad it is. Okay, so we have done just very simple examination like hair plug we have done in this case because this is a frustrated client came to just for second opinion that I cannot do anything like I cannot give oral medicines, I cannot come for the regular visit. So how can you do this? Can I euthanize them like this? So the case client was so frustrated. I have given just one Bravecto tablet to him and said, okay, single tablet you need to give. Then frustrated owner was not ready for multiple visits and even for the oral medicine. Then he was happy, okay, I can give the single tablet. So, after a week he came, 1 week post-treatment, the lesions look amazing. So the owner was so happy that he said, yeah, I can give now oral medicine also. So you can convince owner according to your diagnostic workup. Okay, you can, your owner can faith on you when their case become, responded with your treatment. So you can further guide them according to the cause or what kind of treatment you need to give. So owner will surely follow all your all your talks. So that's it. So thank you.
Hadvet Pharma Private Limited is a pharmaceutical company with its head office at Meerut. It was founded on 29 January 2019 with a vision to provide affordable and quality veterinary medicine to our pet parents. Hadvet Pharma is doing marketing of veterinary pharmaceuticals throughout India. In a small span of 1 year, we have launched 51 products in the veterinary pharma industry to serve our clients. In future 1 year, we are planning to have a product basket of more than 100 products. Hadvet is different from other veterinary pharma companies as we don't have distribution channel. We understand the latest needs of market and for this reason we have adapted to online module of selling our drugs to field practitioners. We are serving our clients by providing the required medicines at their doorstep without any middleman. We directly collect orders online, mobile app, WhatsApp, telephonic from our end customers and we deliver the required products to their doorstep through our nationwide logistic partners Blue Dart, DTDC, TCI Express. We are happy to announce that in our client list, most of the leading pet practitioners of India are included. To assure the unbreakable faith of our clients in our company products, we look after the quality of products, starting from selecting the raw material for our final products, aseptic precautions during manufacturing, and proper storage of finished products till supply to the end customers to ensure quality of products. We are happy to share that Hartwig Pharma has been recognized at various business platforms. Recently, an article on Hartwig Pharma has been published in the leading business magazine, Business Connect. One more milestone in the success story for Hartwig Pharma is that the managing director of the company, Dr. Rajneesh Tyagi, has been awarded Young Asian Entrepreneurs Award at Bangkok, Thailand on 7 February 2020. Our vision states Hartwig Pharma to be a commercially viable leading veterinary pharmaceutical company in providing quality products affordable to various sections of the pet owner society. Our endeavor is to be a front runner in innovation and quality in the veterinary pharma industry. We see a very bright future for our company as we are working in pet industry, which itself is growing at a higher rate, approximate growth of 20% annually. We are regularly working on the knowing of needs of our customers to serve them in a better way. We value your support to Hartwig Pharma and are very thankful to all of you. We look forward for a very strong and long business association between veterinarians and Hartwig Pharma. Thank you.